Hello, B here, and welcome back. Today, we're talking about plants. You may have houseplants at home that you take care of, which mostly means making sure they have enough water and sunlight. But I bet you don't feed them, because plants don't need to eat, at least not in the same way that animals do. Plants are capable of making their own food through a process called photosynthesis. And by making their own food, we don't just mean heating up a frozen dinner. You'll learn more about the process of photosynthesis in a later unit, but for today, we'll focus on how the cells of a plant make this process possible. If plants don't need to eat food, then why do humans? Or any animals for that matter? It would be so much easier if I could just go sit outside in the sun whenever I'm hungry and make my own food. Unfortunately for us, and other animals, our cells are missing a key organelle that makes photosynthesis possible. We do have a few things in common with plants, though. Just like us, plant cells are eukaryotic, meaning they have a nucleus to hold their DNA. And plant cells have many of the same organelles as ours. They just happen to have a few extra ones that we are missing. Lucky them! Just like animals, most plants are also multicellular and have specialized cells to perform different functions. Throughout our lesson today, we will explain key differences between plant and animal cells and explain how specific organelles allow a plant to function. The chloroplast is an organelle only found in plant cells, and in some protists. This organelle is special because it has a superpower. It can do photosynthesis! This is where the magic happens. Carbon dioxide and water are turned into glucose and oxygen, with a little help from the sun. It's actually not magic at all, and you'll study the exact chemical reactions that make it possible in the next unit. But when you're hungry, the thought of being able to make your own food from sunlight does seem pretty magical. Chloroplasts contain a pigment called chlorophyll. Pigments are substances that give color, and I bet you can guess what color chlorophyll is, because what color always comes to mind when we think of plants? Green, of course! Chlorophyll is what makes plants green. It's also what absorbs the energy from sunlight that is needed for photosynthesis. Without it, the cell wouldn't have the energy needed to make its food. Did you know that it's actually possible to buy chlorophyll as a supplement? Many people suggest it has health benefits. Is being able to make your own food from sunlight one of them? Is that the solution to always being hangry? Unfortunately, no. While chlorophyll is necessary for photosynthesis, there are other parts of the chloroplast organelle that are required as well. And at least as of yet, scientists have not found a way to implant chloroplasts into animal cells. So you'll have to settle for stopping by the snack machine. Because of the chlorophyll in chloroplasts, plants generally have a green color. But sometimes plants turn other colors, especially in the fall. As plants prepare for winter, their chlorophyll begins to break down. They won't be able to do as much photosynthesis during the colder months, so they don't need as much chlorophyll. As the chlorophyll gets broken down, and not replaced, the other pigments present in plants begin to show. Mainly reds, yellows, and oranges, providing the beautiful fall displays of color that we are used to. What you are seeing during that time of year is what color the plant would always be if not for the abundance of chlorophyll in the plant's cells. Some trees, called evergreen trees, do not lose their chlorophyll and stay green all year. They tend to have needles instead of leaves and have multiple growing seasons throughout the year, even in harsh conditions. Chloroplasts are perhaps the most important difference between plant and animal cells, giving them the ability to do photosynthesis. But there are a couple of other differences too. Let's take a look. How are you able to stand up tall without melting into a puddle of goo? Well, you have a skeleton, and it gives your body support. Plants don't have bones or a skeleton, and yet some can grow to be over 300 feet tall. So they must have another secret. It's actually an organelle you've learned before. The cell wall. Remember that most prokaryotic cells have cell walls, though animal cells do not. The cell wall sits outside the cell membrane, giving the cell a rigid system of structure and support. This is also why plant cells tend to be rectangular or box-shaped, while most animal cells appear round or spherical. Even though the structure itself is similar to the cell wall in prokaryotic cells, the plant cell wall is made of different chemicals. It is primarily composed of cellulose, which is a carbohydrate and the most abundant macromolecule on Earth. Remember that cellulose is also a fiber. You learned about it back in Unit 2, and it is important for a healthy diet. You get some cellulose in almost any plant-based food you eat because it makes up their cell walls. The other noticeable difference when looking at a plant cell as compared to an animal cell is the presence of a large vacuole. It may take up as much as 80% of the space inside the cell. The vacuole is filled with fluid. Not only does it serve as a reservoir for water and other nutrients, but it also exerts pressure, called turgor pressure, on the cell wall to help maintain the shape of the cell. When a plant has not been receiving enough water, the vacuole shrinks and cannot exert the needed pressure on the cell wall. This is why the plant wilts and looks droopy. Some animal cells do have small vacuoles, but they are not as noticeable in the cell, and the cell does not depend on them to maintain shape. Remember that despite their differences, plants and animals are both made of eukaryotic cells. Almost all of the other organelles that you learned about in the previous lesson on animal cells are present in plants as well. Plant cells have a nucleus, ribosomes, ER, Golgi, vesicles, mitochondria, cytoplasm, and a cell membrane. Being that plants are multicellular organisms, their cells are specialized, just like animals' cells. We said in the last lesson that cells making up muscles would be very different from cells that make up skin or blood or bone. Plants don't have any of those types of body parts, but they do have very different types of tissue, and therefore different types of cells. For example, which type of cell do you think would have more chloroplasts? Cells that make up the root of a plant, or the leaves? The leaves, of course, because not much photosynthesis is going to happen in the roots. They are buried deep underground, away from the sun. Different types of cells would make the flowers, stems, or tree trunks. Being composed of many cells gives any organism the ability to specialize and form cells that are particularly adapted to a certain role. In the PDF, you can read about how a very specialized cell in trees allows us to tell how old they are. What about fungi? Are fungi plants? No, fungi are actually their own kingdom within the Eukarya domain. They have some things in common with plants, like a cell wall, but like animals, they can't do photosynthesis because they don't have chloroplasts. The fourth kingdom within Eukarya, Protists has many species of unicellular organisms which are very plant-like and do have chloroplasts. Green algae, Euglena, and diatoms, for example, can do photosynthesis just like plants. The only difference is that they are unicellular and therefore cannot be specialized with different types of cells and tissues. Well, we now know why plants don't get hungry. At least, not if the sun is shining. Their superpowered organelle, the chloroplast, is like the cell's own little kitchen. And its other organelles, the cell wall and vacuole, help plants have structure even though it doesn't have a bony skeleton. One organelle that keeps coming up in every lesson is the cell membrane. We've hinted at how important it is, being the gatekeeper of the cell. But how does it accomplish that task? That will be the topic of our next lesson in this unit on cells. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science. It's the way of life. Hey, hey.